to the Decahedron RPG podcast, hosted by Joe. Welcome to the Decahedron RPG podcast. Enjoy the show.
Hey everyone, this is Joe. Today, I'm joined by a very special guest. That guest is the amazing James. Hi, James.
Hello, Joe.
A few weeks ago, we recorded an episode where we talked about random character generation versus point-by character generation. And we said, why don't we go away and both create a thief in a point-by system? There's been a little change. We'll talk about that in a second. And come back and report on, you know, what we found and tell about our thieves. We're going to do that. But before we do that, we did get some feedback on that episode. And we are going to reply to that.
Play the footage, man.
Mail call from the United States of America.
Hey, Danik Jason here. So I've got about 12 minutes left in the podcast. I probably should finish listening, but I don't want to forget to mention this because I'm driving. You mentioned method one, roll 3d6 down the line, but technically, actually, as I push up my glasses, when we look in the DMG, method one is roll 4d6, drop the lowest, arrange as player desires. There's no 3d6 method. Method one is in the original method, which I'm sure is how you're using it. The way OD&D started is the DM rolls 3d6 down the line. But method one, as TSR has always defined it, is the DMG 46 down the line. Or, no, I'm sorry, 46 drop lowest, arrange to taste. I know what you meant, but I couldn't resist. Okay, back to the episode.
Do you have anything to say to that, James?
No, you're going to be more on the expert on this, but I believe in the original box set, it was 3d6. I'm not sure if the DM was supposed to do it, though, and it was in a row. Am I not correct on the box set?
First of all, I'm going to address Jason's comment. He is absolutely right that if you look at the DMG, method one in the DMG, right? But those are alternate methods. So that's really alternate method one. So if we're going to be uber pandemic.
Precise.
Pandemic. I would say that method one, as in the original method, which is how he said, I clearly meant it. Yeah, but yeah, so in the player's handbook, it says 3d6 down the line. And in all the non-advanced D&Ds, prior to that, it just says 3d6 down the line. The thing about having the DM roll it, I have heard that many times before, but I own a copy. Actually, I own two copies of the original box set. When I read it, I don't see that reading in there, but I'm also going by memory, so maybe I'm misremembering something, and I don't feel like walking to the other room to grab the book. But thanks for that, Jason. And if you do have the quote from the original about the DM rolling the stats, I'd love to hear it. All right. I think he was just having a little fun with us there. Next voicemail, which is after Jason finished listening to the episode, he left this.
Jason here. One final thought on the point by as opposed to random rolling character generation episode. Great episode. Enjoyed hearing you guys talk. Looking forward to your Big Eyes, Small Mouth episode. And I think that episode might help point out the one criticism I think that got left out for a point by or for, you know, focused character creation, whatever you want to call it, where you're assigning points, is that it requires a level of system mastery that random rolling doesn't. So you can take a player that's never played the game before, have them roll random stats, say for D&D, give them the class, and their character's going to be about as good as any other character, roughly, right? Where if you have a point-by system, you need a system mastery because there are definitely suboptimal ways to assign points. And unless somebody's familiar with the game or has a GM that helps them, they could end up with a character that's not balanced to other characters because they suboptimally applied it to skills and attributes and things like that. So I think the point by character creation requires a level of system mastery not required by the random rolling. Even like Traveler, right? In Traveler, there's a little bit, well, what skill pool should I pick from this career? But for the most part, you could roll up a random Traveler character without ever reading the Traveler rules and jump into the game, where if you had to use point by for GURPS to make a space character, it requires a level of knowledge that the Traveler doesn't, if that makes sense.
All right. Thanks for that, Jason. And before we answer that, we're going to listen to this one from Mirke, because I think our answers will tie in for both of these people. So this is Mirke, Mirke the Meek.
Hey, Joe. This is Mirke. Just listening to your point by versus random rolling. Pretty interesting. Here's a question for both of you, I guess. Which method is superior for onboarding a new player, someone who's never played either of those games before, whatever those, you know, random versus point by games would be? Which method would be superior in that case? I would probably lean more towards the random rolls, but I'm curious to hear what you have to say. My last character was a fighter, and he had pretty good strength and constitution, but I rolled a 6 for dexterity, and this is in 5e. So, you know, that 6 is not good. So I just kind of rolled with it, well, pun intended, I suppose, and made him an old man who can't get around much, but he's got old man strength.
I think he's calling us old, by the way.
For a new player, the rolling system is better. I'll give you even an example. Me and Joseph have been working on my character because he knows the system. And I had started to do it on my own. And exactly what Jason was saying is that I was allocating the points in a manner that was not good for the overall play of the character. Yes, you have to know the game. Or you have to have a DM that knows the game well and can help you along the way. That's my opinion.
I'm going to go backwards. I'm going to address Mirke first and then Jason. So Mirke, by the way, Mirke is the host of the Mirke the Meek podcast, and Jason is the host of the Nerds RPG Variety Cast. Both great podcasts, and links for both of those will be in the show notes. As for better is a weird and nebulous term, and anybody can answer either question. I mean, either point of view to say it's better, because random is better in terms that it's easier. Point by is better in terms that they have a better chance of getting exactly the type of character they're interested in playing. So better is a weird word, which I can't really address. If you mean easier, definitely. And that brings us now into Jason's point. Which one is better for onboarding a new player? 100% random is easier. And you use the example of Traveler and a GURPS space game. We could actually even say GURPS Traveler, right? Because GURPS had a Traveler license for a while. I said it as in quicker when I was talking, when we did the original episode. You know, I said it's quicker. Along with the quicker is, I agree with you completely that random is easier. So, yes, I agree with both of our callers on that. And with you, apparently.
Yeah, me and you were quite going back and forth on the creation of it, the way I created it. And definitely with the first way I had the points, I didn't understand that the points were for everything. And I was allocating them to the attributes more than to the skills and abilities or edge or whatever the proper name is for it.
And so the way I would normally do this around the table, you know, this was kind of hindered by the fact that we're 1,000 miles apart. The way I would normally do it at the table is I would do a lot of that for you, but in front of you so you could see what was happening. And, you know, like I said, that didn't work out well and our schedules are a bit different. So we didn't really have any together time to do that way. Or I would say, you know, I'll do it and I'll show you why I did everything I did. But you specifically said you didn't want me to do it. So then I was like, okay, do it.
Yeah, but like I said, I didn't understand the game well and I was allocating it in a bad way. Let's say it that way.
Big Eyes Small Mouth is a very different paradigm from a lot of other games. It's what we call an effect-based game, and most other games are ability-based games. It's a thing. Also in that wheelhouse is Hero and, you know, all the Hero games. They're like that too, because you have this big list of the attributes, and the attributes don't necessarily apply to the character. They may apply to the character, or they may apply to something that the character owns, or they might apply to another attribute, and it all gets this very layered thing. And in fact, it got so complicated that I said, hey, James, why don't you just make your character in Savage Worlds? And you did, and that took much less time. Yeah, so that's the change that we have, is that when we present our characters, James's character is in Savage Worlds. My character is still in Big Eyes Small Mouth because, yeah, it was already done. So we created two thieves. That's what we said we're going to do. We're going to create thieves. So why don't you go first? You created yours in Savage Worlds. Tell us about your thief. What is his or her name?
Kitty Cat.
No, I just wrote that there as a joke. What is his name?
Oh, I like it. It works for me. I always like to play a funny character, and that works for me. Now, I'm probably not going to get the next part right. He is a Ranchashku male.
He's a tiger man.
I was looking for something agile and fierce. I did want to start with a minotaur, but after a discussion with Joseph, everything I was going for was just so wrong for that particular race.
Minotaur is the bull, right? It's your bull in the China shop. It's big, strong. It's not agile. It's not graceful. You know, it plows things over and breaks them and doesn't care. And everything you had was a graceful type. It didn't make sense.
Abilities. I have Agile 8, Smart 6, Spirit 4, Strength 8, and Vigor 6.
Let me interrupt here for a minute and let everyone know, maybe not everyone is familiar with Savage Worlds. In Savage Worlds, all your attributes and your skills are rated not in a number, but in a die. So when he says that his agility is 8, he's saying that his agility is a D8. And in Savage Worlds, the success mechanic is that you take your die and you roll it. So if you're doing an agility check, you would take a D8. And as long as you roll a 4 or greater, it's a success. If you only have a D4, you have less of a chance of succeeding than if you have a D8. And in Savage Worlds, D6 is your average human rating. And so while he has one rating that's below average, the rest are below above average, so he doesn't have anything that's average. And I will also say that in Savage Worlds, it's a bit of a lie because it is impossible for a player character to be anything less than above average, which is one of the reasons I don't like Savage Worlds. Because even though you're a D4, they do dice chicanery when you're rolling your rolls. Yeah, your chances are never a D4. They are closer to a D8, even though you're a D4 rating. Yeah, I don't like that. Anyway, press on.
The skills I took was climbing at a D6, fighting at a D4. I was trying to get a rogue-type character, so I took gambling, D4, healing, D4, invitation, D4, knowledge, which is arcana, and that's because I also took magic. That's a D4, and lockpicking, D4. Throwing, and that is weapons, a D4, and tracking a D4. The background of the character is I was a bastard of one of the king's daughters. So that's where the gambling part took in. He was a very mischievous person and got into all sorts of trouble. Next part is Edge. I had some racial abilities there. Claws, low light vision. I took Arcana background, like I said earlier, to weapon fighting. My hindrance, and this is a racial one, bloodthirsty, racial enemies. I always like to play this part. He's greedy, so he's always looking for the money. This goes back to when I was being a minotaur, stubborn. That is kind to me in the long run. He's also wanted by the Thieves Guild because he basically screwed up a job and ran out of town. Now he has magic, beast strength, cloud of ash, which blinds people, screaming claws, which is fear and sound. Now the gear, I always tend to do this for most of my characters, is a sword, a dagger, and a bow. So those are the basic stats and ability scores. The rest of it is flavor. And that's one of the things I do like, and I'll leave it at that.
All right, so are we ready for my character?
Yes.
My character is Rosalie Antoinette Tremaine.
Ah, it's making me think of some type of royalty or highborn.
So for the overall setting here, I had something in mind like a huge fantasy metropolis, you know, something like the city-state of the Invincible Overlord or the Free City of Haven, things like that. And you are correct. Her father was a little minor noble. Her mother died when she was extremely young, so she barely remembers her. When she was about six or so, her father was assassinated because it's that type of city-state where, you know, there's all this political intrigue and stuff. And so someone had her father offed. She didn't die in the attack, but she didn't really have any family. So she ended up on the streets living as a waif just in order to survive, in order to eat. And, you know, when you're six, five, you know, you don't necessarily know everything. So she knows that her name is Rosalie, but she doesn't actually know anything else. She doesn't know what house her father was attached to or her surname or anything like that. So living on the street as a waif, she learned to pickpocket, shoplift, the simple cons, all that, just to eke out a miserable day-to-day existence. But she managed to grow and, you know, into her teen years. And let's just say one day, in desperation, she was looking for another way to earn a gold piece. And as she was about to go off and do that, she was approached by Raphael Augustus Tremaine. I just changed his middle name on the fly because I couldn't pronounce the one I wrote down. Who pretty much saved her from that fate. Let's just say, put it like that. He ends up introducing her into the Shadow Lords, which is what they call the Thieves Guild there in the poor part of town there. And he adopts her and he gave her her middle and last name. So that's where she gets the Tremaine and the Antoinette. She thrived. She did good in the Shadow Lords, impressed with her promise and everything. He had a little conversation with her and he explained, you know, that even more valuable than a poor man's coin is a rich man's secret. So he initiated her into a separate branch of the Shadow Lords called the Order of the Rat. Their thing is not so much the pickpockets, bug people type thing, but they target wealthy merchants and nobles. Instead of straight thievery, they instead steal their secrets. And they use them for blackmail and extortion, or just to sell secrets to another noble house, or to use, like, what's the word I'm looking for? High return cons on these
long-term
wealthy men. Yeah, the big con, I guess, would be the term. I'm just looking at my notes here because I got excited. I was speaking off the cuff and I'm trying to see where I am on my checklist here. As a member of the Order of the Rat, they imbue their members with two magic items. So she has a stiletto that's called the Shadow Shard. We'll talk about that in a second. And she has a ring called the Shadow Band. The Shadow Band allows her to transform into a rat. You know, a physical, you know, rat-sized rat.
So she could scurry out of there before getting caught?
Yes, yeah, scurry out, scurry in, all that fun stuff. What else does it do? It does something else. Oh, it gives her, even when she's not a rat, it gives her shadow vision, which is, you know, just seeing in shadow, and the ability to change her appearance, kind of a disguise thing. And I actually hyped up the points on that one because I had points to spend. So her normal MO, you know, is to use her charm to be a socialite and to move within the noble court and get people to reveal their secrets, although she's not above like hiding and eavesdropping, all that stuff. But as such, she has many contacts amongst the nobles. She also has many contacts in the underworld because, of course, she's a member of the Shadow Lords in the Order of the Rat. My last two bullets here are, in addition to doing her duties, though, she's also trying to track down who her family was and to figure out who killed her father and why and eke out her revenge. And also, as a member of the underworld, in many ways, her life isn't her own. You know, the order tells her what she has to do, what her next mark is, what her target is. Sometimes she wonders if Raphael really saved her from a horrible life, or if she just traded one set of horrible for another.
Love that take.
As for stats, I'm not going to go through and list every stat and everything because I don't think people want to listen to a bunch of numbers, especially for a game that they aren't that familiar with. In my experience, not very many people know Big Eye, Small Mouth. But I will list the ones that matter. Big Eye, Small Mouth uses three stats, body, mind, soul. I went pretty average with all of them except for soul. I boosted her soul. Skills, acrobatics for obvious reasons, burglary for obvious reasons, cooking. Actually put 2 points into cooking because I figured that would be part of the charming stuff. Cultural arts, you know, because as a high-end thief, she needs to know what's worth taking. You know, that painting over there is a cheap fake and nobody will pay for it. But that painting, that's a masterpiece. Disguise, obviously. Forgery, obviously. Gaming, again, that's part of being able to socialize and get in with the upper crust crowd. Interrogation, not so much tying anyone to a chair and beating them with a blackjack. Tell us where you were. But this is more just getting people to let their guard down and reveal their secrets. And of course, the combat skills, urban tracking, because she's an urban type thief. Stealth, sleight of hand, and poisons, all, again, obvious reasons, I thought. As for attributes, appearance, again, necessary for that socialite thing. Art of distraction. Oh, actually, I wanted to point out one skill I did not take, and I didn't take it on purpose, even though I thought it would fit the character, and that is seduction, because I don't play those characters. Yeah. Anyway, owned by a megacorp. That's that thing I was talking about with being a member of the Order of the Rat. Red tape, again, that's Order of the Rat type stuff. Skeleton of the Closet, that's because she's a member of the Order of the Rat. So item of power, the Shadow Shard stiletto that I already talked about. Pretty much, it's just a magic stiletto. If it hits you, it's going to do damage every round because that's the shadow part trying to eat you and being consumed by shadow. I'm just looking through the list here. Oh, and then it has an alternate attack, which I call the Shattered Shadow Shard. Try to say that one 3 times quickly. With that one, she pretty much holds the stiletto in her hands and she takes a round to gathering all the shadows in the room around her. And then the next round, they shatter and they fly out in a 5-meter radius, 15-foot radius, hitting everybody there for damage.
That's an interesting one.
You like that?
What type of cost was that for the points?
It's an alternate attack, so I think it's 1 point.
That's cost effective then.
In Big Eye, Small Mouth, again, because you're making an anime character and your anime characters have their signature moves, you pay for your most expensive one, and then any secondary attacks or something that's off of that is only like 1 point. And really, in game terms, there's nothing in the book that says Shadow Shard or says gathers the shadows, right? It's called slow, meaning that she has to take a round to recharge it up. And then area effect is, you know. Oh, and it also gives her Shadow Hide. I only added that at the last minute. It pretty much acts as very light armor. It's just a layer of shadow that covers her. The organizational ties, she has that twice. Once for the Order of the Rat, once for the Noble Court. The other item power is the ring, which we already talked about. All of that. Oh, and she has a magical restriction. Is that all these powers for the ring and the dagger only work in areas of darkness or high shadow. If you go out into the market square midday, they're not going to work. And that's it. That is Rosalie Antoinette Tremaine.
The only thing I have a question on, why did you pick Order of the Rat? You couldn't think of a more interesting name?
I think that's a very interesting name.
Okay. Tomatoes, tomatoes.
So when I make a character like this, especially in Big Eye, Small Mouth, but I would do the same in Savage Worlds, is I come up with a thing first, a theme, a something that runs through the character. For this one, it was the rat. And there's actually a little juxtaposition there, right? Because in the poor neighborhood, they had the Shadow Lords. But in the rich society, they had the Order of the Rat, right? There are these lowly nothings. And so that juxtaposition was part of it. And then the other thing is the rat stuff runs all through this, right? It's the Order of the Rat because their magical abilities, and originally they were going to be spells, and I changed it going through it. But their magical abilities are turning into a rat. If you look at their names, Raphael Augustus Tremaine, that's R-A-T. And she's Rosalie Antoinette Tremaine, R-A-T. So the rat thing runs all through this.
Okay. I see your theme. We definitely work on characters in a different format, though.
And that is going to be a different episode. So, yeah, the next episode you and I do together are going to be talk about making characters backwards.
You're backwards, my forwards.
Exactly. That's what we're going to talk about.
Okay. I was going to say, I think both characters were very interesting and diverse, but they seem to came from the same track.
There were definitely commonalities, and that's because there's certain, you know, fantasy tropes, and things will flow in that trope. And that's not necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah, I want to throw out one thing that I've had a few DMs comment on, but I think everyone does it. Every character we create, usually there's no family still alive, so the DM can't use them against us. Is that a common thing with every player you've done?
No, and that's not even true for all of my characters. Snogan had sons. I had their character sheets too. And I've had other characters with wives and children, parents. Yeah, no, I don't do that. Peter does it a lot. You do it a lot. In this case, I wouldn't even say that she doesn't have living family. She very much considers Raphael to be her father figure, even though she knows he's not her father. So that's family right there. So no, I disagree with you completely.
Okay.
In fact, what is in her backstory, well, her forestory, if you will, for the GM to use at some point, is that Raphael killed her father. But she doesn't know that yet.
That sounds like a devious DM that you may not want to play with.
No, I'm the one that said it. That's what I would tell the DM when I was making the character. At some point, she should discover this whenever. That will rock her world completely.
And then I'm going to ask you a silly question. Would she kill him?
That's a very interesting question.
And I take it I'm not going to get an answer.
Because Order of the Rat, she needs to know not so much that he killed him, but why did he kill him? Who hired him? And so is her revenge against him, or is it against whoever hired him, or is it against both? A lot of that would depend on how the GM had played that relationship with Raphael up until that point. And I don't know. It's not that I'm hiding the answer. It's that I don't know yet. I would have to see how the situation unfolded and respond to it and react.
You're making me think of an old TV show with all these twists and turns you give me.
All right. Well, I think we covered everything. I am going to announce a next giveaway. Let's say by the Ides of March, you have to have your entries in.
Rome theme?
No, it's just I was trying to think of a date that would give time for our people to do their thing. So the Ides of March is 15 March. Call in, write in, whatever. Do say that you are entering the contest. We're going to make this a little internal contest, James. Let us know if you liked Rosalie Antoinette Tremaine better, or if you liked Kitty Cat better, or if you don't want to take sides, write in with your own thief. Let us know about your own point buy type thief. Make it in any game you want. I suppose I could even allow D&D if you use the point buy stat thingy.
Any version?
Yeah.
Okay.
And the prize will be a set of fudge dice, because I don't think enough people have fudge dice. And if you do have fudge dice, you don't have enough. Just call in and say, Joe's character was a whole lot better than James's. Or I suppose you could flip that for some weird reason. Or say, both of your thieves suck. Mine is better. And show us your thief. Yeah, you don't have to say ours suck. I'm being very playful and tongue-in-cheek. So, all right, let me just wrap up the show. So, James, thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having me.
And everyone else, yeah, thanks for listening. Do send feedback. All their information is in the show notes below, or they're at www.decahedron. And until next time, happy gaming, happy life. Bye.
Thanks for listening to the Decahedron RPG podcast. Please come back.